morning, everyone, and happy Sabbath. As we start this hour of worship, I'd like to ask those who can please join us in kneeling.
No.
I'd like to ask you all to please join us in standing as we sing our call to worship.
The glory of the Lord is in this place. Come worship in this place, in the glory of the Lord. The presence of the Lord is in this place. Come bow down in this place, in the glory of the Lord. In the glory of the Lord.
Our Father in heaven, once again, we are grateful to you for your blessings. Thank you, Lord, for your protection that you gave us this past week. And as we are about to worship you, we pray that you may give us open hearts, that your Holy Spirit may be here with us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Good morning again to everyone. I hope everyone had a good week. I hope everyone feels blessed. We're happy to have you here in the house of the Lord, and where two or three are gathered in His name, things will be done. And I'd like to lift up our voices now and sing praises to God as we begin our first song, Peace Like a River.
I got peace like a river, I got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river in my soul. I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river in my soul,
in my soul.
I got love like an ocean. Love like an ocean, I've got love like an ocean in my soul,
in my soul.
I've got love like an ocean, I've got love like an ocean, I've got love like an ocean in my soul,
in my soul.
I got joy like a fountain, I've got joy like a fountain. I've got joy like a fountain in my soul. I've got joy like a fountain. I've got joy like a fountain. I've got joy like a fountain in my soul.
In my soul.
I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river in my soul. I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river in my soul.
Amen. Amen. Get us loosened up. Our next song, you know what time. Hello, family. Good morning.
Peace
Happy Sabbath.
Family, we are family. Jesus is our God. And I'm so glad He brought us all together. I'm so glad.
Around 11 last night, because we left here late.
That's okay.
And I saw it. Wow. I heard the message. I hope they remember the pictures I sent.
But Janet.
He is our God. Oh, I'm so glad He's brought us all together. I'm so glad that the Father is our God. Family.
To bring us next, talk about how great God is. It's indescribable. There's not enough words.
From the highest of heights to the depths of the sea, creation revealing your majesty. From the colors of fall to the fragrance of spring, every creature unique in the song that it sings. Indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awesome, we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing, God. Told every lightning bolt where it should go, or seen heavenly storehouses laden with snow, who imagined the sun and gives source to its light, yet conceals it to bring us the coolness of night. Indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awestruck, we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, you are amazing, God. Indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. All powerful, untamable, awesome, we fall to our knees as we humbly proclaim, You are amazing, God. Indescribable, uncontainable, you place the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. Incomparable, unchangeable, you see the depths of my heart and you love me the same. You are amazing, God. You are amazing, God. You are amazing, God. Oh, Jesus. You are amazing, God.
God is so amazing. So amazing. There's not a time that you don't see how much He loves us, and you can't help but want to fall in love with Him.
Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus was the best thing I ever done. Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus was the best thing I ever done.
In His arms I feel protected. In His arms never disconnected. No. In His arms I feel protected. No place I'd rather be.
If you believe it, sing the song with us. Falling in love.
Falling in love with Jesus. Falling in love with Jesus.
I'd rather be
in His arms. time, there's no place.
There's no place I'd rather be.
Sing it like you mean it, church.
There's no place I'd rather be.
Amen. Please be seated.
Like to say good morning to everyone. It's good to be in the house of the Lord, right? The Bible says, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. So church should be the happiest place on earth. It is not Disneyland, right? But we're happy because Jesus is here. We want to take this time to welcome everyone to our church, and especially our guests this morning. And also take the time to welcome our internet audience who is watching via the internet. And so we want to recognize you at this time. If I read your name, I'd like for you to raise your hand and keep it up, because we have something to put in your hands. So the first one is Wei Wang. Right there, God bless you. I assume that's your brother?
That's my nephew.
Or your nephew, okay. Oh, praise the Lord. Welcome. God bless you.
Amen.
All right. We also have Lisa and Catherine Jones visiting us from the Ephesus SDA Church in Richmond. Where are you at? God bless you. All right. Keep your hand up. Thank you so much. We also have David and Naomi Walter from Canton, Ohio. Where are you at? God bless you. Welcome to our church. Do we have any other guests with us this morning? All right. Anyone else? Okay. Just raise your hand if you're a guest. Okay. God bless you. All right. This morning we have a couple of things that we need to take care of, and that is we are going to have the second reading for Jennifer Hainer from the Manassas Church to our church here. And I know we usually give them a little gift, but the gift is here. But they are not here. But we're still going to do the second reading. So is there a motion to accept Jennifer into our fellowship here? Is there a second? Any questions or discussion? All those in favor? Okay, thank you so much. We want to remind you that we have an appointment every week here in our church. I'd like to encourage you to come out, and I guarantee you that you are going to receive a blessing. Come out to prayer meeting every Wednesday at 7 p.m. And we are continuing our series on discipleship. If you'd like to know how to work for others and how to witness in the way that Jesus did it, come out on Wednesday night and receive a blessing. Let's continue to remember those on our prayer list. And you notice the second name at the top there is the Nettenberg family. They are a family that has come, visited our church from time to time, and I am sad to announce that Rana Lee passed away last Sabbath, and so we need to pray for this family. And also, there is a name up there right after Rowan Bernard, and that is Elvira Morales. Elvira Morales is the grandma of one of the visiting families here in our church. And we were there last night, and she passed away last night. And so we need to pray for the Morales family. Also, we need to pray for the Wagner's family. Tom, I understand that your grandpa passed away. So we need to pray for Tom and his family. And anyhow, we also need to pray for the last name there, that is Jason Grimes. He had an accident yesterday. He cut his hand, and he had surgery, or he's going to have surgery today, this morning. And so need to pray for the Grimes family. Also, as a matter of prayer, we need to pray for the people that are going through the storm, even as we speak right now. The people down in Texas, and so we need to pray for God to intervene and keep them safe. It's a big storm that we don't know the damage as of yet. I was given this announcement to announce to the kids that the soccer practice will continue tomorrow. And anyways, we're coming to the end, right? Coming to the end. I know you had a good time. Amen. I know the kids have had a good time as well. Last week, we selected the pre-nominating committee. And if you're a member of the pre-nominating committee, we have a meeting here in the library right after the service. And talking about that, I forgot to bring something to your attention last week as it pertains to that. The church board recommends that we do, instead of a one-year term, that we do a two-year term. So that comes as a recommendation for the next officers to have 2 years instead of 1 year. So that comes as a recommendation to the floor. Is there a motion to accept this recommendation? All right, is there a second? Any questions or discussion? All those in favor? Oppose? If you oppose, talk to me afterwards. All right? All right. Now you notice our lawn is nicely trimmed and cut, and that's because the deacons and other individuals in our church have taken upon themselves to do that. It's a big job. I helped one time, and I tell you what, I was reminded as to how old I was, but it takes several hours to do that. But they need help, and so if you have some time to do that, please talk to Steve. Steve, raise your hand. He's our head deacon. Talk to him, and he'll give you all the information. He'll be more than happy to accommodate you whatever day you want to come in, all right? All right. We have another meeting taking place today, and that is the adventure meeting. And that is for all the teachers who are going to be helping with the program for this this term. And that is going to be downstairs in the kitchenette. And so if you're a teacher, please come and be there. Our meetings are about to start. And you've seen the banner outside. You've seen some yard signs as well. And I was told this week that the handbills are done, and they are going to be distributed between the 2nd and the 5th of September. And of course, our meeting begins on the 9th of September. So we still have a few handbills to hand out. If you were not here last week and like to pass out to some of your friends and neighbors, we still have some of those here. See me afterwards, and I'll give you some as well. All right? In regards to that, we know that this is getting into Satan's territory. Anytime you and I become involved in evangelism and sharing the gospel with others, we know that Satan is angry. And but we also have a weapon, and the weapon is prayer. And so during the meetings, what we're going to do is we are going to be praying as the meetings are going on in a room there at the school. And so last week it was announced that we needed some help in that. But we still need some more spots to be filled. And so at this time, I'd like to invite Esther to come up and just give us a brief announcement. Amen.
No, Pastor has said it. I don't need to say anymore that we really need prayers during this meeting, because we want the Spirit to use Pastor to present the message the way God wants it to be presented. And again, we need the Spirit to make the right interpretation to the people so they hear exactly what Pastor has presented to them. And with this, everybody can be what? A team prayer. Last week, I had made 50 copies, and the 50 copies were handed to people. We had to make more copies. And how many copies did I get? Two. So today, I'm going to give everybody the opportunity. If you are willing to support this seminar and you want God to bring people in and hear the message, the least you can do is what? To pray. Amen. So we are passing the papers out. When you put your name, just say your name, phone number, and prayer. And then I will get it and I will make a schedule. Initially, I say 2 people, but the more people I have in the praying room, the better. Thank you. And when you are done, put it in the offering plate.
All right, thank you so much. That is all I have. Once again, welcome to our church. Thank you.
All right. Happy Sabbath. All right. Before the children goes and get the basket, I just want to remind you, parents, elders, guide the children to go through the aisles so that they can collect the money. Oftentimes, the older people have the money, but the children just come straight out. So give, and the kids, give the adults chance to make commitment to you. If they don't have the money, they will promise you to bring it next time. So children, you can go back, get your basket. It's time for the Lamb's offering. And this is for the TLC Prep Scholarship Fund. And we want you to give generously, okay? Thank you.
Got a few more. Hey. a smaller crowd today, end of the summer, probably final vacations, right? Good to see you all. Welcome back for some of you. How's everybody doing? Yeah? Did you see who came back to see us? How you doing? Good to see you. You look very pretty today. So, this morning, I have a story I want to share with you about when I was a kid. Yeah, it is funny, because I was a funny-looking kid. So, who likes riding bikes? Anybody?
I do.
You like riding bikes?
I do like riding bikes.
That's exactly how I feel. It's the same look. I love riding bikes. I want to tell you a story. When I was little, my older brother and I used to go riding our bikes a lot. And one day, my dad, he took us up to the top of this mountain. So we went, and there's this big mountain. And you go up to the top, and from there, they have a big tower on top. And on top of the tower, you can look out all over Western Massachusetts. So all over the Pioneer Valley. So you can see several cities from up on top of this mountain. It's an awesome view. And now, I was little, so I didn't have any type of fancy road bike. I had it was a Huffy. It was this ugly, ugly yellow Huffy, but it was my bike. And I also liked to jump. My mom didn't like that, so I was grounded a lot because I wasn't supposed to jump. So kind of like school shoes, you don't do anything other than go to school with them. This was my bike, and I wasn't supposed to jump with it, but I used to always go over jumps, and those bikes weren't very strong, so because I used to jump so much, my handlebars were stripped. They didn't have the cool handlebars they do now. So my handlebars would go whoop, whoop. And my tires, my front and back, especially my back one would go like this, whoop, 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 when I rode. So it wasn't very smart. And you can ride your bike when you stand up? Very cool. Well, yeah, what's up? You got a Lightning McQueen? Shazam, pachow, kukui. So, nice. Well, you know what? Back then, we didn't have any special equipment. When you ride a bike, what do you have to ride now? What do you have to wear when you ride a bike? You do, but we didn't wear helmets back then because we weren't very smart. But I loved baseball. And growing up, we had a small minor league team called the Holyoke Millers. And I never wore this except for when we would play our sandlot baseball. So we would always have pickup games of any sport there was. And we went to go riding, my brother and I with my dad. And I said, you know what? And I hate hats. I really don't like wearing hats. But that day I said, I'm going to wear my Holyoke Millers hat. So I went. I haven't worn it since I was about your age. Anyway, and you can see it's pretty filthy. Anyway, my little brother, he found this and he gave it to me recently. So this helmet, I decided, you know what, I'm going to wear this when I go ride my bike. And we rode up that mountain. It was a big mountain. We got to the top. We looked out. We saw all around Pioneer Valley, all beautiful Massachusetts, all the trees, the mountains, like, so nice. And then guess what you have to do? You have to go back down the hill and go home. So I had that helmet on, and you can see what this looks like, right? So just a little plastic on side. It's something you get as a souvenir when you go to the game. So I had that thing on my head. I had that thing on my head, just like that, and I'm riding my bike. And as we're going down the mountain, we were picking up speed, and I didn't have any front handbrakes. The only thing I had was the disc brake where you just step on it and it would put the brakes on. Unfortunately, because I used to jump with my bike, my wheel, both wheels were really bent, and the back wheel, as I was riding, my whole bike went like this. At first it was boom, 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 boom. But as I picked up speed, because the mountain was really steep, it was boom, 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 boom. And so I was like this. And I didn't know what to do. I just knew the faster I went, the more. And I kept going. And faster. And I was like, if I put my brakes on, I am going to wipe out. And it was bad because the mountain was now going down a highway. So that was the way we got back to Mississippi City. So my bike is, and I was like, do I put my brakes on? No, because I'll wipe out. If I don't put my brakes on, I'm going to wipe out. And I thought, what if I just do it just a little bit? That's how it sounded. What do I do just a little bit? And I went down, and I slowly went, pressed the brakes just a little bit, and I thought maybe if I just a little slight rub or slow it down, and guess what happens? Whee! I flipped over my handlebars because my bike went out of control because it was, my wheels were bent because I didn't take care of my bike. So as soon as I tapped the brake just a little bit, and I did it really soft, and I was really good with the bike, but my bike wasn't meant for that kind of damage to go down at that speed. And I went, and I went over, and I went, boop, and somehow, look at that. This thing with no straps managed to stay on. You can see a scrape right here. So Mr. Jason, landed on his head. Explains a few things, so no jokes, all right? So I landed on my head, and I was still holding on to my handlebars because I had went over it, and I landed on my head, and I bounced, and then I went all along the highway. So now I was in the middle of the highway. And my dad and my older brother were up ahead of me, so they didn't realize what happened. And so I bounced. The helmet managed to stay on long enough for me to hit my head, and then I bounced again, and I tore open my side. So I had a big, big tear open on the side. And I had all this highway rock and gravel and sand in there. And somehow, I managed to grab my bicycle, my helmet, and run off the highway before the car hit me. And of course, my dad and my brother stopped because they heard the noise in the car. And the lady and her husband ended up taking my bike in their car with my dad and drove me to the hospital. And as we were driving, they say, we have no idea how you managed to do that because we were this close to hitting you. Because when my bike was here on the off of the road, but when it flipped me into the middle of the highway. And somehow I managed to, they said, how'd you get up after doing that and get off? I have no clue, but I do now. I do now. And there's something that we have to remember is this here, I was just doing it for fun. I wasn't even thinking about safety. I just wore this because the Holyoke Millers were the baseball team in my local area, and I thought, I'm going to wear that. And I want to share something with you because I think this is important. When we're thinking about the stuff that we do, and we think about the world we live in, and we think about what we do to take care of ourselves, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord, and in the power of his might, put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God. I didn't have that. I just had a plastic helmet. That ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand, stand therefore, having your loins girt about with the truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, and take the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. And for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in bonds, that I therein may speak boldly as I ought to speak. Now, I know you guys probably don't understand half of that, but there's something about this, and I want to make you understand. So Mr. Jason still likes bikes. Can I get a volunteer? You want to volunteer? Come on. You want to volunteer? All right, how about you volunteer? Stand up. Here, Caleb, stand up. Here, can you hold the microphone? All right. So we were told to put on a few things, right? All right, here we go. Perfect fit. There you go.
we've got to read the whole thing. And God tells us to go boldly. It doesn't help us if we wear all this equipment and we have no bike to ride. Why have the equipment? God equips us with the Word. We have the Word of God, and we're given it to use. And God tells us to go out boldly. So if we take all this that God gives us, we take the shield, we take all this that He's taught us, and we just sit there and leave it in a closet, that's not doing what God asks us to do. We have it, use it, take what you know about God, go out there boldly on the streets, and live as an example for others.
Amen. Amen.
Let's pray, guys. Come on.
You want to pray? Yeah.
Thank you for God and Jesus. Thank you for the whole family. And help us to be good. And help us be kind. And
Amen. 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 Thank you. You all can head back. Thank you.
Worship and giving, and this is for Potomac Partners. I would like to read, you all know this verse by heart, which is the Malachi 3:10. Bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse and prove me now. That's just for emphasis. Prove me now, say the Lord of hosts, if I will not open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it. God actually desires to bless us with the riches of heaven, but we must exercise faith in His promises and take Him at His word. And then the step of faith you take now will have immeasurable rewards. May the deacons please stand as we pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to give back what you've given to us. You, the one who give us the power and the energy, and everything belongs to you. At this time, we pray that you help us to give lovingly. And we remember those that may be going through hard times, some who would like to give and not be able to give. We just pray that you will bless all of us. And may this giving continue to further your word throughout the world, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. night. It's now time. Gotta pray first. Got enough prayer? Sabbath. So as our custom is, or if you have anything, a pressing need, you can come forward. And we ask the congregation, if you can, to at least bow down, kneel as able, as we go and seek the Lord in prayer. O merciful Father, God of heaven, who makes heaven and earth, we thank you for another week. Another week closer to home. We thank you for bringing us here to worship you, because you say that we should come and worship you. And you've set this day apart and you've blessed it. There are many people who don't know about it, but we pray that the blessing of today will be on all of us. Father, we first pray that you forgive us all our sins. Continue to be with us. At this time, we have people who come to the front, and those who are kneeling down at the pews, we just bring our petitions to you, whatever it may be. It may be for healing. It may be for unruly kids. It may be for the kids walking away from the Lord. It may be for jobs. Whatever it is, you know. And our prayer doesn't bring us to you. You know all our needs. But we will not forget to give you praises. In all our needs, we want to give you praise too. And at this time, I want to pray for our congregation, for the seminar that is going to take place. This is the commission that you give us, Lord. So we pray that you use this church in a mighty way, and that the Holy Spirit will impress upon the heart. And we know whether it's one person or 1,000, the work will be done. So we pray that you use the pastor in a mighty way, and everybody that will be involved, that the Holy Spirit will guide, so that the seed will be sown and hearts will be converted. Father, we remember all the sick, those people who are having really, really tough time. We remember the families that the pastor read about, the Wagners, those who have just lost their loved ones. And at this time, we pray for consolation, that you be with each family, Lord. We pray for the Grimes that caught his hand. Bring healing. Father God, there are so many, many needs. Heal us and use us in a mighty way, we pray. And as we continue with worshiping you this time, Lord, please bless us and use us. May our faith increase. May you lead us in the way that you want us to go. bless this whole congregation. Be with the young people. Continue to lead them and guide them because they are the future of tomorrow, Lord. And I pray that as the pastor will deliver the manna, that you use the Holy Spirit to speak and to touch us. And we pray that you bring us into the week of prayer and then to the next Sabbath. And finally, Lord, that everybody represented here, our extended family, the Fredericksburg, and the whole world and the General Conference and everything that we do, because you're going to bring all your people from all faith, that at the end, whether we've gone to sleep or we are alive, that we will all inherit the kingdom of God. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now it's time for our scripture reading. And the scripture reading is found in Exodus 3, chapter 3, verse 5 to 6. Exodus 3, verses 5 to 6. Please say amen if you are there. Amen. Okay. Here it goes. Then he said, "Do not draw near this place. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place where you stand is holy ground. Moreover," he said, "I'm the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. May the Lord bless the reading of his word. Amen.
Morning, church. Happy Sabbath. Looking through a window blurred with rain, emotions run together in a flood of doubt and pain. We've prayed as best we can, now we must leave it in His hands. Yet I know when my eyes fail to see, He is able. And even though it seems impossible to me, He is able. But if He chooses not to move in the way we prayed He would, confident He's working all together for my good, I will stand behind His word, for He is able. questions seem to haunt us night and day. How could God allow our hearts be torn this way? Does he listen when I call? Is he even there at all? And yet I know when my eyes fail to see, he's able. And even though it seems impossible to me, he is able. Oh, but if he chooses not to move in the way we prayed he would, confident he's working all together for my good, I will stand behind his word. For he is able. My God is able. And as the night gives way to dawning and evaporates away, I'll stand to face another.
The Lord. I think I can just sit down with that song. just wanted to communicate something to you. If you read your email yesterday, you received a letter from me. How many of you received that email? Okay. So just wanted to communicate to the church this morning what the email was all about. If you're on the on the email list of our church, you should have received it, but it has been about 3 years since we've been here. Next month, on the 23rd of September, is going to be 3 years. Hard to believe that, right? But we praise God. God has blessed our church in a mighty way, and I believe that God has greater things for us. Wanted to tell you that the conference has looked at our church, and they have come to the conclusion that our church serves as a model church for the conference in terms of ministry, in terms of involvement, in terms of growth. And so what they want to do is use our church as a training center for new interns that are coming into the ministry to do the same thing in other churches in the conference. And so they have extended or expanded our territory. We are now going to be part of a district, and we are going to have Stafford, Culpeper, and Orange as part of our district. And so because of that, the conference is going to put an associate pastor that is going to be here in our church, focusing on the youth and the children of our church for 30% of the time. And then 70% of the time he's going to spend at the other churches. And so, you know, we praise God for that. And so we want you to pray that God may continue to use us. Already, some of our elders are involved in preaching at these churches. So they're familiar with our elders, and we are going to lend further leadership to these smaller churches. And so we praise God that we are going to have something that we don't have, and that is we're going to have an associate pastor that is going to, not full-time, but part-time, something that we don't have right now, that is going to spend 30% of the time, I wish it was 70, 30% of the time here, and then 70% of the time there. And so I'm still going to be the full-time pastor here. So I'm not going anywhere, okay? We are going to have this intern. I'm going to be the supervising pastor for this intern. Pray for me. Pray for us as we continue to work in this capacity, all right? So anyways, when is this going to start? It's going to start when they select the new associate pastor, all right? So that's going to take some time. They're going to take, a few months to select the person. And so pray as they go through the selection of the new associate pastor, all right? So, there we are. Let's pray. Father in heaven, once again, we are grateful to you for your blessings, and we pray that as we open your word this morning, Lord, that you may forgive us for our sins, cleanse our hearts. And Lord, we pray and plead for the power and presence of the Holy Spirit to be here with us, in us, and speak to us, Lord. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. And so today we continue our journey entitled Journey to the Promised Land. And what we said is that just as God took the children of Israel out of Egypt and led them step by step all the way to the Promised Land, God is willing to take us, his children today, his people, out of spiritual Egypt and lead us step by step all the way to the Promised Land. And of course, the Promised Land is heaven. Amen. Are you making plans to go to heaven? Yeah. Amen. Amen. That's why we're here. And so today we're going to look at the topic, The Encounter, Part 2. So Part 1 was last week. If you missed it, by the way, fear not, because you can go to the church's website and find the message. All right? So today is going to be Part 2, and we focus on Exodus Chapter 3. In Exodus Chapter 3, we find the story of Moses, and we notice that he was in Egypt for 40 years, the first 40 years of his life, and then he did something. Do you remember what he did? What did he do? He killed someone, right? And now he was a fugitive. He was banished from Egypt. In fact, he didn't want to come back because they had a sentence awaiting him. And so he spent 40 years in the desert, 40 years taking care of sheep. I mean, every day was the same, right? As he went out, the sheep looked the same, the mountains looked the same, the trails looked the same, the sky looked the same, everything was the same. But God changed his life, amen? Kind of reminds me of sometimes we might say, what am I doing in this job? All right, you might think that. But let me say this. Think about it this way. Your current job may be God's preparation for what he has for you next. Think about it. He has something greater, something bigger for you. And so the Bible says, as we read last week, that he took the sheep on this particular day, and he took the sheep on the back of the desert on Mount Horeb. And Mount Horeb is a reference to Mount Sinai. How old was Moses now at this time? He was 80 years old. He was working past retirement, right? He was still working. He was still strong. In fact, the Bible says that even though he was that age and even older when he was 120 years old, his natural force or his physical ability was not diminished at all. He was a strong man, right? And so, do you think he thought that his life was over? I mean, after all, 80 years old, and now for 40 years taking care of sheep, he might have thought that his life was over. But God, who is always interested in our affairs, God, who is always there to lead us and tell us what to do, comes to him and he speaks to him through a bush, a burning bush, right? So I'd like for us to open the Bible to Exodus chapter 3 and verse 4. Exodus 3, 4. If you have it, say amen. The Bible says, "So when the Lord saw that he turned aside to look, God called to him from the midst of the bush and said, 'Moses, Moses,' and how did he answer?" He hears the voice of God, and he says, "Here I am." In that answer, you can tell that Moses was willing to do God's will. In other words, what he was saying was this: I am available. I am ready to do whatever you want me to do. If God calls you, if God has a task for you, how willing are you to do it? All right? So, let me say this. Just as God called Moses to do something, God is calling us. Amen? God is calling us because he has something for you and for me to do. So, he says, "Here I am." God is not so much interested in our ability, but our availability. In other words, you may be able to do something, but the question is, are you willing to do it? Sometimes we put up excuses not to do what God has called us to do. Sometimes we say, "Well, Pastor, I will go and invite people if it's not too hot, or if it's not too cold. I'll go if I have time, if it fits within my what? My schedule," right? And so, not to downplay our ability, but God is more interested in our availability. If God speaks to you, if God calls you to do something, how willing are we to do it? Sometimes the devil puts in our minds 1,000 excuses not to do it. Some people say evangelism is dead. Well, I want to tell you it's not. Because God is interested in the salvation of people, amen? God is interested in us being involved in this process of telling people about Jesus Christ. Amen? And so, God is interested in our availability more than our ability. God is interested not so much in our house, but in our heart. Amen? God is interested not so much in our summer tan, but in our surrender. Amen? Now, if you get a tan, that's okay. All right? That's fine. But more than your summer tan, God is interested in our surrender. In other words, are we willing to surrender our life to him? Every area. Sometimes we say, "Well, Lord, you can have this part of my life and this part of my life, but not this part over here. This is mine. This is precious to me." Are we willing to lay it all on the altar of service for him? God is interested not so much in our career, but is interested in our character. What type of person am I? What type of person do I want to be? How willing am I to allow God to work in my heart to change my character into what he wants us to be? Sometimes we say, "Well, honey, that's the way I am." The question is that the way God wants you to be? Sometimes we excuse that, right? Sometimes we say, "Well, I inherited this trait, this strong character in my life from my mother or from my father." But is it according to the character of God? That's the question, right? And so the Bible says that Moses answered, "Here I am." He was willing to hear the voice of God. He was willing to go where God told him to go. Now, he has some issues at the beginning, as we shall see in our next few messages, all right? But so far, when he sees this burning bush and he hears the voice of God, and he hears his name being called twice, he says, "Here I am. I'm willing to do whatever you ask me to do." I want you to notice in verse 5, the Bible says, "Then he said," this is God speaking, "God says to Moses, 'Do not draw near this place. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place where you are standing is what? Holy ground," right? And so, what we find here in this sentence, God says, "Don't come near this place." Now, that's odd, because sometimes people think, well, God wants us to draw near to him. And that is true. But there is a lesson, I believe, that God is trying to communicate to Moses. When he says, "Don't come near this place," it says, "Take your sandals off your feet, for the place where you're standing is what? Is holy ground." Because God came down upon this bush, this ordinary bush, because God manifested his physical presence in this bush, that place where the bush was standing, and that place around the bush all of a sudden becomes holy ground. Because wherever God manifests his presence and his power, that place or that person becomes holy. Amen? And so God is trying to teach him a lesson that says, hey, I am approachable, but you have to remember that I am what? I am holy. Right? I am holy. Yes, God wants us to come as we are, but he wants to change us into what he wants us to be. Amen? The holiness of God. Sometimes people forget that God is holy. In fact, if you look at several experiences, not only in the Old Testament, but also in the New Testament, you find that God manifests his presence in a mighty way. And the first thing that is struck, that people are struck by, you might say, is the majesty and the power and the holiness of God. When God manifested himself to the prophet Isaiah, remember the prophet Isaiah? And the prophet Isaiah in chapter 6, the Bible says that he sees a vision of God. He sees God sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up. And surrounding the throne of God were angels. And the Bible says that the seraphim, they had 6 wings. With 2 wings, what did they do with their face? They cover their face. With 2 wings, they what? They cover their feet. And with 2 wings, they what? They flew. And what did they say before the presence of the throne of God? Holy, holy, holy. The whole earth is full of his what? Full of his glory. Can you imagine that picture? What if you and I were to see the majesty and the presence and the power of God, as Isaiah did? Well, he was so struck by the majesty of God that he says, "Behold, I am undone, because I am a sinner. I'm a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips." The majesty of God, the holiness of God. When Daniel was allowed to see the majesty of God, he almost had the same experience. The Bible says that he felt no strength in himself, and he was sick for a few days. What would happen if we would see the majesty of God? Sometimes we forget that God is holy. In fact, some people take upon themselves, and you know, sometimes we have to be careful, sometimes people take upon themselves the title of reverend. There's only one reverend in the whole world. Holy and reverend is his name. Psalm 111 and verse 9. So when people say, how should we address you? This is outside people. Should I call you reverend? I said, no, just call me pastor. Okay? Just call me pastor. That's good enough. Right? So in this experience, where God says, take your sandals off your feet, for the place where you're standing is holy ground, God was trying to show him a lesson. And the lesson is this: God wants us to understand that he is what? That he is holy. In fact, in one of the miracles that Jesus did, Peter was so struck by the power of Jesus Christ that he says, "Depart from me, for I am a what? A sinful man." You see, when you and I are allowed to look into the holiness of God, then we really see ourselves as we really are. And that is sinners in need of his grace. If it wasn't for the grace of God, none of us would be here. If it wasn't for the grace of God, we would not be able to get up in the morning. Amen? If it wasn't for the grace of God, we would not be able to take another breath. But because of God's grace and God's goodness to us and God's holiness, we are here. Amen? We are here before his presence. Today, people dismiss God. And when people dismiss God, they dismiss the holiness of God. God's word is holy. Amen? My wife sometimes gets on me because sometimes I put the Bible in the car and she says, "You should take care of your Bible. You are a pastor." Amen. Sometimes you need people to tell you what you need to do. Amen? Amen. That's all I'm going to say about that. It is interesting that in some cultures, if you travel around the world, when you go to church, I went to church in India, and when you go to church, you are suddenly confronted with the thing right in on the front door. People take off their shoes. And you go inside the church without shoes, and I wonder why people did that. It goes back to this right here. When you come before the presence of God in the East, all right, people take off their shoes. In fact, in some houses, they have a place for your shoes right there. Right? Take them off. God was trying to communicate to Moses that he was holy. The Bible says in verse 6, "Moreover," he said, this is God continuing to speak to Moses, "I am the God of your" what? "The God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. I mean, what would you do if for 40 years you've been looking at this bush or passing by this bush, and it was an ordinary bush, and all of a sudden God manifests his presence there, and he speaks to you directly by name, and he's talking to you? How would you react? Would you be afraid to look upon God? He says he was afraid. He hid his face. He was afraid to look upon God. And so, the Bible says there in verse 6, he says something very significant. He says, "I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." In those words, what he was saying was this: I want you to understand that God wants to be with us. Yes, he is high and he is mighty and he is holy, but his innermost desire is to be in us and with us. Amen? And that's a testimony to his grace, because he doesn't have to. God doesn't have the need to be with us. In fact, the need is ours. We need God more than he needs us. Amen? And so God wants us to understand his willingness to be with us. He says, "I am the God of your father." Now, he mentions three names. The God of Abraham. When you think of Abraham, he was a man that was called by God. He was a man that was willing to be led by God. Amen? And so, God is saying, "I am willing to lead you in your life." What are you facing today that is a difficult decision? What are you facing today that is a problem in your life? Whatever it is, God is telling us through this verse that God is willing to lead us, just as he led Abraham out of the Ur of the Chaldeans, God is willing to lead us. Amen? Are we willing to be led by God? Are you willing to be led by his hand? Then he mentions Isaac. Isaac, of course, is the son of the promise. When he mentions the name Isaac, he says, I am willing to provide whatever you need. Amen? As you remember, when Abraham took Isaac, his only son, up to Mount Moriah, and as they came to the foot of the mountain, he told his servants, stay here while me and the lad go up there, and we will come back to you. And so as they go up the mountain, the Bible says that Isaac says, well, Father, here's the fire, and here's the wood, but we're forgetting something. Where's the sacrifice? Where's the lamb? How does Abraham answer? God himself will provide himself a lamb. And God did, amen? And God did. And so, when he mentions Isaac right here, he is saying to us, I am willing to provide for you. You may see no way out. You may think your situation is impossible. You may think you're facing something that you haven't faced before. But I am willing to provide for you. I cannot tell you the many times that God has provided for us. And we say, there is more month than money. Have you faced that before? More month than money. And all of a sudden, God, out of nowhere, provides for us. We praise God for that. Amen? We praise God for that. So, when he mentions Isaac, he's saying, I am willing to provide for you. You don't have to worry. All you have to do is trust. Amen? All you have to do is believe. Now, the third name that he mentions here is Jacob, the God of Jacob. You know what Jacob did? Sometimes we point the finger, but you have to remember, he's talking to us, amen? He's talking to us. And so God was willing to forgive Jacob for his sin, just as God is willing to forgive us for our sin. And in mentioning Jacob here, in this verse, he's saying, I am the God who's willing to forgive you. I want to tell you, one of our greatest needs is not money. It's not prosperity and material things. It's not advancement in our career. Our greatest need is Jesus Christ. Our greatest need is forgiveness. Our greatest need is for us to be one with God. Amen? And so, God is willing to be with us. Think about it. He doesn't have to. But he does it anyway. Why? Because he loves us. Amen? Because he loves us. Now, if you look in verse 7, the Bible says in verse 7, and the Lord said, this is God still speaking. Amen? I want to tell you, when you open your life to hear the voice of God, he's not going to speak once or twice. He's going to continue to speak. And as we live the life that God has mapped out for us, he's going to continue to speak to your life. Amen? So the Bible says in verse 7, and the Lord said, I have surely seen the oppression of my people who are in Egypt, and I have heard their cry because of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. Did you get that? There's a reason why God comes to Moses. He is telling him, hey, when you think that I am not aware, I am aware. Because I know. He says, I have surely seen the oppression of my people who are in Egypt. Some people think that God is only interested in our spiritual well-being. And he is, by the way. But he's also interested in our physical well-being. This was physical oppression in the highest sense of the word. And it didn't happen just one year. They were oppressed for a long time. by the Egyptians. And God says, I have seen the oppression of my people who are in Egypt, and I have heard their cry. You can just imagine, year after year, decade after decade, century after century of oppression, the people's heart were crying out to God, when, Lord? When are you going to deliver us? When are you going to help us? When are we going to be free? And so the Bible says, I have heard their cry because of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. Oppression causes sorrow. Oppression causes sadness in people's lives. And so the Bible says here that God is aware, amen, that God knows. God wants us to know that he is concerned about the sufferings of his people. That's the next lesson that we find here in this story. And so the Bible says in verse 8, so I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians. Do you think that was good news to the ears of Moses? I have come down to deliver them. Praise God. No one can withstand God. Amen. And I could just imagine Moses saying, yes, Lord, I am happy that you finally heard our prayers. I am happy that you finally have come down to bring deliverance to your people. And so the Bible says in verse 8, I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians and to bring them up from that land to a good and large land, to a land flowing with milk and honey. So Egypt is not your final destination. God is going to bring you out of Egypt and take you to somewhere that is better, amen? To a land flowing, the Bible says, with milk and honey. A large land flowing with milk and honey. In other words, God wants to take them from Egypt all the way to the promised land. Amen? The Bible says, to the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites. Perizzites, P-E-R, not P-A-R. Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites. Now, if you ask me, that's a lot of ites, okay? So, God says, I have something better. I have something better for you. And so we said, just as God took his people out of Egypt and led them step by step all the way to the promised land, God is willing to take us out of spiritual Egypt and lead us step by step all the way to the promised land. As beautiful as this world is, as nice as your house is, in fact, we're going to go to somebody's house this afternoon to have a special prayer. It's a beautiful house. As beautiful as your house is, this is not your final home. Amen? God has something better. Amen? A land flowing with milk and honey. And the best thing about heaven, I'm talking about heaven, the best thing about heaven is that Jesus Christ is there. Amen? Jesus Christ is there. And so, as you think about the sufferings of the people of God, they suffered long. Their burdens were heavy. In fact, the Bible says, if you remember in chapter 1, they built several cities on the backs of the Israelites. There was no relief. In fact, as we shall see, when they asked to be relieved, they increased their task and their work and made it more difficult. Does it seem sometimes that the more you ask for deliverance and the more you ask for relief, does it seem that Satan kind of tightens the screws on your life and things don't get better, but that sometimes they get worse? Don't give up. There is hope. Amen? There is hope. And so you think about all the cities that they built. Think about all the time that they spent working day in and day out, without pay and finding no relief. You think about that, the fact that all they wanted to do was to be delivered and to be free. Well, God heard their prayers. God says, I have heard their cry because of their taskmasters, and I know their sorrows. And guess what, Moses? I have come down to deliver them. Moses was happy up to this point. Next week, we're going to see how truly happy he was. When God says, well, I have a plan, and you are part of the plan. We're going to see what God says to us next week. As you think about Jesus, you think about the fact that the Bible says that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. That means that his grace is still available. That means that he hasn't changed. That means that God is willing to deliver us of anything and everything that oppresses us. Because you see, today, we live in spiritual Egypt. Sometimes we get too comfortable in our lives. And sometimes God has to rattle us out of our comfortness to remind us that there is something better that God has for us. That there is a goal that we are reaching to, we're trying to reach, and that is heaven. As Jesus looks down upon this world, he's looking down to see if you're willing to listen to the voice of God. And not only hear the voice of God, and as you hear your name called, he's willing to see if you say, I am willing. Here am I. Here am I, Lord. Send me. Sometimes we're confronted with a situation in our lives where it is necessary for us to do something. And sometimes we think, it's somebody else's job. It doesn't fit my job description. Well, I want to tell you today that if God has brought to your attention a need, could it be that God is calling you to do something about that need? Don't dismiss it, but hear the voice of God. Today, the God who understood the sorrows of the children of Israel understands our sorrows, understands what you've been through, or I would say, what you're going through. Because there are some people today that even though they smile today, when you greet them at the door and they say happy Sabbath, inside they're suffering. Inside they're going through some issues and problems and tribulation. And they may be discouraged, but they're here. I want you to know, if you are that somebody, God understands. God is willing to deliver you, amen? There is no one like Jesus Christ. There is no one that loves as he loves. And so today we want to pray. Let's bow our heads. Father in heaven, today we understand that you call our name. And you want us to respond, Lord. You want us to say, here I am. You want us to understand that you're holy. You're the God of majesty and power. But you're the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, willing to be with us, Lord, willing to fellowship with us, willing to lead us by the hand, willing to provide for us, and willing to forgive us. Father, some of us are going through some horrendous things, some things that no one knows, only you. Today, Father, we understand that you hear our sorrows and hear our cry. You see our struggle. If that is you this morning, and you're crying out to God, and you're saying, God, I need your help, I want you to raise your hand right where you are. God sees your hand. God sees your hand. God sees your heart. Father, you see the hands. You see the lives. You understand, Lord, what we're going through. So, Father, today we pray in a special way for everyone that has raised their hands. And if you're watching via the internet, you can raise your hand too. You can say, I need help. I need God in my life. If you would, please let us know. As you see the number on the screen, call that number. Let us know of your decision. And I want to close this message by extending an invitation to anyone that is here. Maybe you are here because your parents brought you. Maybe you're here because a friend invited you. Maybe you're here because you felt a need to come to church today, but you have never given your life to Jesus. If there's anyone here, at the sound of my voice, who has never given their life to Jesus Christ, but you want to say, I want to do that. I want to give my life to Jesus Christ. If that is you, raise your hand. Is there anyone here? Praise God. Praise God. Father, we pray for this young lady here. We pray, Lord, that as her desire to follow you, to turn her life over to you, we pray, Lord, that in turn you may come into her life in a mighty way. Shower her with your blessings, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for being so good to us. Thank you for hearing us today. In Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen.
Is in 625 if you would like to reach for your hymnals in front of you. Higher ground, it'll also be on a screen in front.
I'm pressing on the upward way. Eyes on gaining every day, still pressing as I onward bound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lift me up, then I shall stand. My faith on heaven's stable land, a higher plane that I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher. To stay where doubts arise and fears dismay, though some may dwell where these are bound, but where my aim is higher ground. Lift me up and I shall stand, my faith on heaven's table. Bye. bright and catch a glimpse of glory bright. But still I'll pray till am I found. Lord, lead me on to higher ground. Lift me up and I shall stand. My faith on heaven's stable land. A higher place that I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. We stand.
I'd like to remind the pre-nominating committee the following people: Bill Hagerman, Bill Jones, Jason Maloney, Esther Opoku, and Stephen Stewart, that we're meeting in the library for about 5 minutes. All right? Let's pray. Father in heaven, once again, we are grateful to you for your blessings. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you, Lord, for your willingness to be with us and live in us. In spite of us, we pray, Lord, that we may respond as Moses responded, "Here I am. I'm here. I'm available. Tell me what to do." And so, Father, we pray for each one here, those who are watching via the internet, in your church around the world. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Also, the teachers for the adventures are meeting downstairs in the kitchenette. Thank you.
I'd like to remind you as well that there will be an elder in front of the organ.
I just want to praise you forever and ever.
Because of who you are, I will lift my hands, I will lift my heart, and sing a song of love to you, because of who you are. I offer you my life, surrendering. To you because of who you are, everything you are, because of who you are, I will lift my hands, I will lift my heart and sing. So because of who you are. Because of who you are, I will lift my hands, I will lift my heart and sing a song of love to you.
The dark.